Yeah, praise God, man. It's good to be here together with you guys, and it's always good to gather together. The Bible says as the time gets closer, we need to get together more. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. It's a good thing. So tonight, you know, during praise and worship, that last song that was being sung, we sung for a while there, that just assured me of what I know the Lord was wanting me to talk about tonight and stuff. And so I want to talk about promises a little bit. Promises from the Father.
Oh, yeah.
And we are, I know all of us in here, and I know everybody in this place tonight. I've at least met you, or we've known each other for a while, and I know everyone in here is born again. So I'm preaching to born again people tonight, amen? Or as Brother Hagin said, born again, you know? And born again, amen? But God has promised us, number one, new life.
Amen.
All right, we understand that. That's the major promise. Once we give our life to Jesus Christ, we go to the cross. We look to Him. We kneel at the cross. We give our life to Him. We ask Him to save us. We repent and get over into that and do that. He's promised us new life. Amen. So we leave this earth. We have new life. We'll be resurrected into heaven. Praise the Lord. We'll live in paradise. We'll live with our Father. Worship Him. We'll be there. But there's also other promises that God has given you to your life personally while you're here on earth.
Amen.
Not just new life. New life is the best. That's the ultimate. There's nothing that can even come close to even topping that. Because we all leave this earth and we're going somewhere and praise God. And then we're born again and saved. Your life, Christ, we're going to heaven. Hallelujah. That's the ultimate promise.
Amen.
It's His Son, amen, coming for us and doing what He did for us, amen? But there's also promises that God has talked to you about, or even maybe when you were even a little child, there were things that maybe you know God had spoken to your life about, to you, or maybe He sent somebody in your pathway to speak something to you, or to say something over you concerning your life, or God maybe has given you maybe a dream in the years past about something and you knew it was a God dream. I mean, because, folks, let's just be honest. You know when it's a God dream and when it's just a dream. You know what I mean? I mean, there's something that it shakes you to the core. It rattles you on the inside, and it just never leaves you. I mean, it's there. And so there's some of you that have had dreams in the past where God has promised you certain things or something like that. Maybe He has shown you certain areas of your life, something that He has for your future, something you need to do, something that He has for you to do concerning the ministry or concerning something like that in the future, and He's shown you those things. So we've all received promises from the Lord. And you know, you can look back at one of the biggest stories in the Bible as far as promises to me, what I read about a lot, is Abraham and Sarah. You know, that's a familiar story. We know that story. How, you know, the Lord told Sarah, you know, you're going to have a child, you know, when you're of age. And it also talks about there, I believe it's in Genesis, where it talks about her that she even laughed at that, you know. Because she just, wow, even when I'm old, that's going to happen, God, you know, that kind of stuff. So we know the story about them that Abraham, it wasn't happening, so he went
Hagar.
And of course, Ishmael was born and all that stuff. He got ahead of God. He got ahead of the promise. He got ahead of what God had said. And then finally he repented, came back, and did it the way he's supposed to. Then Sarah gave birth, praise God, and all that good stuff. So we know that story. But that was a huge promise because in the natural, no one would believe that. That a woman of her age would become pregnant and give birth to a child at their age. That's, I mean, even right now.
Yeah.
If I heard of that, I would have to see that to believe that. And 80, you know, she's really that lady's that is pregnant? I mean, that's just something that you can't, you know. And then you think about Mary. There's another promise that was just like, what? Okay, she got, you know, pregnant.
Yeah.
I mean, without having a man, you know. There's promises that God will say to us and things He'll say to us. And right now, you can sit there and think about yourself. There's things that God has said to you that might not have come to pass yet. And on the inside of your brain, when you look at your intellect, you think, how can that even happen?
Yeah.
Right? I mean, you know what I mean? But when we get over into faith,
amen.
God said this.
Yes.
It's like I used to hear Brother Hagin say, God said it, I believe it, and that settles it.
Amen.
Because if God said it, He's going to come through, guys. He's going to do it. He's going to prepare that way, open that door, move someone here, move someone. Whatever He's got to do, He's going to do it to get that promise fulfilled. Amen? And the awesome thing about God is He knows when the time and the season for that promise to be fulfilled. He knows that. So it's not our job to try to manipulate that promise to come to pass. It's not our job to wish it'll come to pass. It's not our job to try to make it hurry come to pass. It's our job just to believe the word of the Lord and do it and continue to do what He says for you to do.
Amen.
Because folks, there's not just one promise God's given you. There's tons of promises God has promised in your life. And as we walk with Him, I say it this way, as I trust in Him and as I rest in Him, that manifestation will come into me and out of me.
Amen.
Of what He's promised.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
When we trust Him, when we rest in Him, that manifestation will come as we're going along in life. Not trying to figure out how do I do work for the Lord. Don't try to figure out how to do work for the Lord. Just have a relationship with Him and He'll lead you right where He needs you to work. His works.
Yes.
And bring the glory to Him. Amen?
Yes.
So there's a lot of promises that God has said to us. There's a lot of dreams that God has given us. There's a lot of visions that God has given us. There's a lot of insight in the Word that maybe you were reading a scripture or a passage or something, and God illuminated that thing in front of you, and it just jumped off the page. He began to show you something out of that for your future and made it very, very plain for you. You know, one of the promises He gave me was, you will live and not die and declare the works of the Lord.
Amen.
That's a promise He gave me. I woke up out of sleep quoting that scripture in January of 2009 after I was healed with leukemia.
Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you.
I had just had a God dream. This dream was wild, man. This dream I had, and I remember, see, it's like, this is back in 2009, it's almost been 10 years, and I remember this dream like it was yesterday. Yeah. I was in my dream, I had just gotten done being healed of leukemia, and the year 2009 came around. It was at the end of 2009. I had to see my doctor at the end of January for the first time in like over a month. I hadn't been down there. And now, see, this was a process where I was going like pretty much every day during that year, right? So he said, okay, I don't want to see you for another month, he told me. We'll check your blood, see how it's going, all that kind of stuff. So in that waiting period there, the devil's there, and he's chirping, oh, it might come back. What if your blood's bad? You're going to have to start this whole process over again. You're not that free from it. You're going to have, all this junk. Yeah, the devil is, right?
Yeah.
Well, I was asleep in bed one night. Obviously, hopefully I was in the bed or I was on the couch. I don't know if Monica might have kicked me out. But anyways, I was asleep, and in this dream, what I saw was, I was at the doctor's office down there, and I was in this room where they take their breaks, the break room. And I was in this room, and I was sitting in there in this chair, and all of a sudden my doctor came into this room. And he came into this room, and I acknowledged him, he acknowledged me. And he came over and he sat down in a chair next to me, and he pulled out a newspaper and opened the newspaper and began to read it. And I'm sitting here, going, what's the doctor doing, And here about just a few seconds later, these two men walked into the room. And there were male nurses. There were male nurses. They had the outfit on that they wear and all that stuff down there. And there were two men. And they came in and they stood there and they said, hey Mike, hi. I said hi. And they acknowledged the doctor. He said hi. And they said, we came here. We saw you. And we came here. We heard that you were healed of leukemia. Can you share what happened? So I began to share how the Lord healed me and this and that. And after I got done sharing that with these two nurses that were in there that I thought were nurses, but I believe they were angels in the dream. And I'll tell you why I thought that, because this is what happened next. After I shared the testimony of how the Lord healed me, and they began to sing, worship.
Praise God.
And it was in chant form. You know how like you hear Latin, or I don't know what it is. Like that, they started to worship like that, right? And it was the most beautiful thing I'd ever heard in my life. And I stood up immediately because I felt the power of the Lord in the room, And I began to chime in with them and worship with them. And I looked over at my doctor, and my doctor was doing the same thing. And I thought that was interesting. And the dream was over. And I remember waking up and coming out of my sleep, I was saying, I will live and not die and declare the works of the Lord. I was saying that out of my mouth as I came out of my sleep. And immediately, I got out of bed immediately and I started to write down exactly what happened because I knew it was a God dream. That's a promise from God to me.
Yes, sir.
And why is that? It's because he knows the devil's going to try to attack, try to lie, manipulate, torment, bring fear, all that. And God gave me that promise that you will live and not die and declare the works of the Lord, showing me that that junk ain't coming back on you. No matter what the devil tries to do, you're going to walk through what I've called you to walk through, and you're going to declare my works and fulfill the promises that I've given you.
Amen.
And that goes for you guys.
Amen.
And see, this is awesome in here tonight because I know that you guys know that, and there's so much faith in here. I don't have to try to convince you or, you know, try to get you over into this and believe in this. You guys believe this. That's why you're here tonight. Praise God.
Amen.
But see, there's promises. There's dreams. There's things that God has said to you. Don't let those things go dormant. You've got to go back and pull them out where you have those things written down or typed out whatever it is, on CD form, video form, whatever, someone's saying it audibly to you in a prophetic word, start pulling those things back out.
Amen.
Amen.
And rehearsing those things over and over in your spirit. Read those things over and over in your spirit. It builds your faith. It lays a foundation where you can see, even if it feels like it's kind of getting dark and all this kind of stuff, God opens that back up and you begin to see. That dream comes alive in you again.
Amen.
Because it's a precious promise from the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. And it's funny because even some of you, you'll probably go back and read over some of those prophecies, or you remember some of those words that were spoken over you, or those promises that were given you, and some of them might have been fulfilled already in your life. Yeah. That happens. But there's still some, I guarantee you, that hasn't been fulfilled yet. And that's the mark. That's the goal. That's the target we should be heading for. Whatever those promises are, we walk with the Lord and He'll lead us right into those promises, praise God.
Yes. Amen.
We have not hit the pinnacle in this ministry.
That's right.
Yeah. Amen.
At the Believer's Church of Madera. We have not hit the pinnacle yet. I know that.
That's right.
There's a ways to go. There's a lot of stuff happening. But things are happening. We've been watching, and me and Dad talk about this all the time. We've been watching God raise up leaders in this church, man. You guys raise up the core foundation of the Believer's Church of Madera. And we're watching people that are playing their part, their members in particular, praise God. They're being the pinky, they're being the thumb, they're being the toe, they're being the arm, they're being the leg. We're watching the foundation people that are here that are solid. We're watching them go out into the marketplace and do what God has called them to do. This is a living church. It's not a dead church.
Amen.
This is a church that's full of life. This is a ministry that's full of life. This isn't the Dead Sea. The river is flowing through this place.
Amen.
Praise
Come
God.
On.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
That should encourage you because I'm telling you that God has mighty, 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 mighty things in store for the body of Christ.
Amen.
Grab a hold of that, man. Grab a hold of them. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Amen.
But those promises are real.
Yes,
you know, last Sunday morning, there was a tongue and interpretation given last Sunday morning. And I gave the interpretation of that tongue and that prophetic word. What it talked about the what I saw, the vision I saw was I saw a window in heaven open. And I saw God it was like I saw His hands like come down through that window there. And it was like He was like blessing us or helping us or something like that. It was like He was there. I knew He was there. It was there, like He was showing us that He's here. He's helping us. His arms reaching out to the earth, amen, for us. And when I saw that, all of a sudden I saw us just come up like eagles and begin to soar on the wind that the Lord is blowing and the wind that He's doing, the wind of the Holy Ghost, you know. And that was basically the prophetic word. And so during the week, I just kind of chewed on that. You know, I'm like, okay, Lord, is there anything else that You want to show me out of that? Man, I'd like to know, you know, if there is. And I really didn't hear too much until on Thursday morning. I was reading this prophetic word that was posted on the Elijah list that morning by a man by the name of David Herzog. And he began to share this prophetic word that the Lord gave him. And He gave him a word and showed him several cities where there was a portal of heaven that was open, that was getting ready to open, or that was already opened over these cities for revival and for the harvest to come in, the harvest of souls to come to the Lord. And so He listed off these cities And there were several cities. And as I was reading these cities, my mind goes, I hope I come across Madera. There was about a dozen of these cities he listed here that God has showed him. So I'm reading these cities. And as I read and I got done, I said to myself, well, man, I didn't see Madera on there. And the Lord said, I've already opened that portal. That's what I showed you on Sunday morning. And I was just like shocked, man.
Come on.
I fired me up, said Peter. I was like, yes!
Yeah.
That's it, Lord. You've already opened it.
That's right.
You showed us. And so I can't stand here and say fully what that fully means or what's going to happen. I mean, the Bible says it's going to happen if we'll just believe the word of the Lord and go out and do the works he calls us to do. He'll do works through us, amen? Yeah. But I know that there is a portal open over Madera, California. Guys, Madera, listen, there are wells that are being dug up right now in unlikely cities. Madera, California is an unlikely city in the world's eye. For a mighty move of God to hit, guys. Let's just be honest. A lot of people don't even know where Madera's at.
Hallelujah.
Okay? That's just the truth.
They will.
But they will. And that goes for a lot of other cities all over this valley. There's, you know, I'm telling you, that it's coming. It's like that wave. It's rising and rising and rising. You go to the beach and you stand on the pier and you watch those surfers. They know when you'll see them just kind of sit there and about three or four waves will go by and they're just like, eh. But they're waiting for the right one. They know it's coming. And then you'll see them. There's like 10 of those guys out there. All of a sudden, you'll see them start to maneuver and start to get ready because there's one out in the distance that's coming. And no, it doesn't look like nothing at the time, but they know by the time it gets to them, they're in a spot where they're able to propel themselves, swim, and catch that sucker. That's what we're doing right now. We are in preparation time of that big tsunami wave to hit, praise God. And when it hits, glory to God, our heads are going to spin.
Yeah.
In a good way.
Amen.
Some of you are going to have to quit your jobs because you're reaping too much harvest.
Amen.
Yeah.
Wow.
You think about it, and it sounds awesome, and it sounds cool, but I'll tell you, I've read stories about certain revivals that have happened, and the way it just changes people's lives.
Yeah.
I'm not talking so much about the spiritual side of it, but the natural side of it.
Yeah.
I mean, you're just ministering and ministering and ministering and ministering. When a move of God hits like that, they say, I've never been a part of something like that yet. I'm going to be, but they say that it's as easy to get somebody saved as it is to shake somebody's hand.
Amen.
Yeah.
It's just God is there and the love is there and the compassion is there. And His presence is there.
Amen.
And that's what I'm looking for. That's what I want. I'm going to be about Father's business now. We are to be about Father's business now, but man, that day's coming to where it's going to be those things where, like back in the 50s and 60s, man, people just run into those tents, man, because the power and the love of God and the glory of God was there.
Yeah.
And families were getting saved. People were getting healed. Things were happening. Man, A.A. Allen jerking people that were skin and bones out of cots that were dying of cancer, man, and just getting healed instantly, stuff like that.
Yeah.
Tell me that ain't going to shock the world.
Yeah, it is. It'll shock us.
Yeah.
Yeah, it will. You got that right. I've never seen anything like that in life. I've seen people get healed, but I've never seen something that dramatic.
Amen.
By God. And that's what I want. Ever since I was a little kid, and you heard me refer earlier about when you were little kids, there was something maybe, or growing up, there was something that you knew, or just you sense something, or you know, when I was a kid growing up, my thing was I want to see the book of Acts happen. I used to think about that all the time. I want to see the stuff that they talk about in the book of Acts happen. And I saw bits and pieces of that, but I knew there was more.
Yeah.
Amen.
To that.
Yeah.
I knew there was more. Amen. So let's go over here real quick. Turn over to let's go over to Romans chapter 4. So there's promises that are still, I don't know how to say it, in the air for you.
Yeah.
They haven't come to pass yet. But God hasn't forgotten him. He's not a liar. He's not going to say something to us and then just ditch the idea. It's not going to happen.
Amen.
He said something to you, then that thing surely will come to pass.
Yes.
Romans chapter 4, let's look at verse 13. Now I love, in my Bible, the title of these verses here is called, the title says, The Promise Granted Through Faith. I love that.
Oh yeah.
So we're going to touch on an element of there's promises, but there's you also got to have some faith.
Amen.
You know? So it says in verse 13, For the promise that he would be the heir of the world was not to Abraham or to his seed through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. For if those who are of the law are heirs, faith is made void, and the promise made of no effect, because the law brings about wrath. For where there is no law, there is no transgression. Therefore, it is of faith, say, of faith, that it might be according to the grace, so that the promise might be sure to all the seed. Not only to those who are of the law, but also to those who are of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. As it is written, I have made you a father of many nations, in the presence of him whom he believed, God who gives life to the dead and calls those things which do not exist as though they did. Who contrary to hope, in faith, believed so that he became the father of many nations, according to what was spoken, so shall your descendants be. Now see, God had promised him to be the father of many nations. And I mean, you think about that. I mean, it's funny because we think that God says wild things to us, but they're really not wild, they're the truth.
Amen.
And it's like Mom said this morning, I heard her say this, you know, anytime even God says something to you, something, or even if the devil says something to you, something, we need to look on the inside right away. Instead of trying to figure it out with our intellect or what's going on in here, how do I fix this? How do I do that? How can that be? We need to look inside here. Okay, well, what'd you say, devil? And you look immediately on the inside to see what God says about that. And if God says something to you, you look immediately on the inside and say, God, what do you say about that? You know, because when he says something to us, it's a promise. It's going to come to pass. Amen. He tells the truth and nothing but the truth. Amen. His word is established. Yeah. He's already created you. It says in Jeremiah, verse in chapter 1 there, it says when he created you in your mother's womb, he predestined you, which means he's already set you apart. He's set your life apart. He's called you. And I know that not everybody responds to that call and follows Christ. I know that. But we do because we're in here tonight and I know we're born again. So he has set us apart. We came into that promise, that life that God has for us. We stepped into that. When he set us apart, we stepped into that and we want to be used by him. We want the gifts and the callings to come out of us, praise God. And as he promises you that, you've got to what? You've got to grab a hold of that by faith. And say, all right, Lord, here it is. You've said this to me. I believe what you've said, God. Now, Lord, it's not my duty or my job to make your word come to pass. It's your job. So, Lord, I believe that. I receive that. I got that seed on the inside of my heart. I got a hold of that. And I'm just going to follow you. I'm going to have a relationship with you, Father. And when the time and the season comes, boom, you're going to make that come to pass. And what I love about God is it's not just one promise to us.
Amen.
There's many.
Yes, there are.
Many. And in those promises, and listen, I'm not talking about new cars, new homes, I'm not talking about any of that tonight. That's part of it. It could be. He'll bless you with that stuff.
Yes, he will.
But what I'm talking about tonight is the promises that he's given you. Most of those promises aren't just for you, but they're for other people. The promises he showed me in my life, when he said, you will live and not die and declare the works of the Lord. That promise he gave me, well, that's not just for me. It is for me, so to speak. I mean, I'm going to be alive, and I'm going to finish the work of the Lord unless he comes back and takes us before that's over. That's great. But I'm going to be alive for my wife, for my children, for my family, and I'm going to be alive for the people that God wants to use me to effect for the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
That's how I look at it.
Yes.
So it's not only just for you all the time, but it's for others. There's promises he's giving you. He's going to use you. And he already has used you, but he's going to use you even more to affect people's lives for the love of the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Verse 19. And not being weak in faith. Now listen to what Abraham did here. I love this. And not being weak in faith, he did not consider his own body. He did not consider his own body already dead. So, I like to say it this way. Abraham, I wrote this down, Abraham did not try to figure God out.
Amen.
He didn't try to figure out how is this promise going to come to pass. How is it going to work? How is that going to happen, God? There's no way. Naturally, physically in the natural, my body's dead. I cannot do that. But by faith, he didn't consider his body dead. He didn't look at the natural. He knew that it was going to have to be supernatural. Guys, let me tell you something. That promise that you have, that dream, that vision, that thing that God has put in your life, or you're stirring about right now, I mean, you're thinking about it right now as I'm talking to some of you, that thing, it will not come naturally. It's going to have to be supernatural.
That's right.
That's right.
It's going to have to be delivered by the Lord.
Yes, amen.
I saw myself standing in front of a crowd of, I don't even know how many people, tons of people. And it was like I was standing there, and it was just this vision I had. And I had this staff in my hand. And I was standing on this stage, and I had this like wood staff type thing in my hand. And this is when I was 20 years old, 21 years old, I had this vision, driving home from Turlock, California. And as I was driving home, I can even show you on the freeway where I was at. I was right before I got into Livingston right there. That's back when they had that stoplight on the freeway. Remember that stoplight in Livingston on 99? It was right before that stoplight, heading south, coming home. And I had this vision of me standing on this big, huge, like, you know, you go to you see rock concerts outside or some kind of concert, that was big, huge stages. I was standing on the stage, and there was just a sea of people. And I was standing there by myself, and I had this, like, big wood staff in my hand. And I had this, like, Native American, like, headdress on. Like the I don't know, I guess the chief would wear or something like that or something. I had one of those things on, and I was standing there, and there was just a sea of people. And I lifted this staff, and as I lifted it, there was starting to become a rumble in the crowd of, like, noise, like, you know. And I went, and I slammed that stick down on the stage, and when I did it, it was like just a, I mean, I feel goosebumps.
Yeah.
It's probably the anointing. It was like a roar went up, like a praise went up to the heavens like I have never heard before. It just shook the place.
Hallelujah.
And it was like the power of God was just, and as time has gone on, this has been, you know, 21 years ago this happened. And as time went on, the Lord has shown me things about that dream. There's probably more he wants, or that vision. There's probably more he wants to show me, probably, but he showed me that was the army of the Lord.
Come on.
Now, I don't know why I was up there. I don't know, maybe he just showed me because I was going to lead some folks, you know, maybe down the road or whatever, into some things or whatever. But it was just like, and so anyways, he shows you these things. You know, I don't know if that's ever going to happen, like I'm going to stand up there and do something like that. I don't know if that'll come to pass. But one thing I do know is that I am going to lead people in the army of the Lord.
Amen.
I know that. That's happening.
Amen.
You know, and I say that very humbly, if you know what I mean, right, guys? Okay.
Yeah.
So anyways, that shepherd anointing that's on my life. So he says here, 19, and not being weak in faith, he did not consider his own body. He wasn't trying to figure things out. He wasn't, you know, whatever. He said, already dead since he was about 100 years old. And the deadness of Sarah's womb. So you got two factors here. Abraham's 100 years old, and Sarah's womb is dead because of her age. I mean, and God tells you, you're going to be the father of many nations, man. You're going to have a child. His name's going to be Isaac. I mean, God, I mean, think about that. I mean, that just sounds crazy in the natural. But I love Abraham, man. That dude had some faith. He didn't consider himself dead, too old to do that. And it says here in verse 20, he did not waver at the promise of God through unbelief. He didn't waver at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strengthened in faith, giving glory to God. Amen. See, Abraham didn't allow himself to get over into unbelief and doubt. Don't allow yourself to get over into unbelief and doubt what God has promised you about your kids, your husband, your wife, your family, your call, whatever it is He's called you to do. Don't get over into unbelief. Don't waver at that promise. Know that that promise is true. I know that sometimes we'll get weary, we get tired, we get weak. Abraham did it. He tried to do the work of the Lord for God. And got us into problems, and we're still in those problems today. We forgive Abraham, but we're still in some of that because he got over into, well, maybe I better just kind of speed things up here. God's kind of taking too long. How many of y'all have ever been guilty of that before? And how many of y'all ever got frustrated while you're waiting for that promise to come to pass? Lost your temper, said things, whatever, you know? Got frustrated, gave up for a couple weeks, and you came to your senses finally and realized, wait a minute here, you know? Well, that's what happens sometimes. Not everyone's perfect, amen. But it says here, he gave glory to God and fully convinced that what he had promised, he was also, and being fully convinced that what God had promised, he was also able to perform. And therefore, it was accounted to him for righteousness. Now, it was not written for Abraham's sake alone that it was imputed to him, but also for us. It shall be imputed to us who believe in him who raised up Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was delivered up because of our offenses, and was raised because of our justification.
Thank you, Lord.
Folks, we were justified in Christ.
Yes.
We've been justified. That word justified there means to acquit and declare righteous.
Amen.
We have been acquitted. Amen. Because we are declared righteous.
Yes.
In the sight of God.
Amen.
You are, and I'm going to say this, you are worthy,
yes.
You are holy enough,
yes.
And you are able enough to do what God has promised you to do in your life,
Amen.
What He's called you to do. You are able to do it.
Amen.
It don't matter if you're 100 years old like Abraham was, if your womb is dead like Sarah was, it does not matter. If God has promised it, He's going to lead you right on ahead. Now let me say this. This is a huge part of this because this is something that we all have to learn and we're still going to have to learn no matter what. We cannot try to get ahead of God. But we can't, listen, I would rather err on the side of being a little behind than being ahead of God.
Right.
If that makes sense.
Yeah.
I don't know, you might maybe feel a little different about that, and that's okay. But I would rather maybe miss it a few times, than miss it all the time because I'm way out in front trying to do something by my works and what I feel like doing. This is a good idea,
yeah.
And all that kind of stuff.
That's right, come on.
Amen?
Amen.
God knows exactly what you need to do tomorrow. He knows exactly what you need to do Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. He's got it all lined up. He's got it all planned out. He's set you apart. He's predestined you. He's called you. He's anointed you. He's equipped you. He's given you everything you need, praise God. Listen, some of you have been sitting in this church so long, you know the word just by osmosis.
Amen.
Larry Huggins prophesied that to me one time. I got it, man. He said, Mike, you don't need to go to a Bible school. You don't need to go to any theological school. You don't need to go to any seminaries. You don't need to go to any of those kind of things. You know the word just by osmosis more than some of those do that go to those schools for years. Because you've sat in it. You've heard it taught. You've listened to it. You've got it on the inside of you, praise God. All you sit in this place, I know all of you. You've got enough. I've been around you long enough. You've got enough word in you to preach the house down to save Madera.
Amen.
You do. It's in you. You got so much life on the inside of you, so much love and compassion on the inside of you. It just takes one handshake, one word, one smile that Jesus will show up in those people's lives, guys. Start looking for that. Start taking chances.
Yeah, that's right.
Amen.
That's right. That's what it's about.
Amen.
Amen. Don't let the devil intimidate you and keep you in fear. Well, that person's going to hate me. That person's not going to like me. That person's going to cuss me out. Well, just, you know, hey, that's the way it goes sometimes. But listen, I guarantee you're going to have way more success in people wanting to receive the love of God than you're not going to have success.
Right.
Because it's here.
Yeah.
People are ready, man. The devil's system is being torn down in the United States of America.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lord.
It's coming down. Yeah. We're watching it crumble. We're watching it crumble.
Hallelujah.
We've been praying and praying and praying and praying and praying, and the devil is flat ticked off.
Good.
So what?
Yeah. See you. Don't want to be here. He is irritated and mad. That's why he's turned the heat up, maybe in your life personally. Because I'll tell you, once you make that decision to follow Christ, you're a target. Now, I don't say that to get you nervous or scared. We have authority over the enemy. We win. We got the covenant, the blood of Jesus. He did that for us. He protects us. We have authority. We stand on the Word. We trust the Word. We believe the Word. We do the Word. We're in a safe space, man. God will protect us and keep us. Amen. No weapon formed against us shall prosper. Every lying tongue that rises against us. But the Bible says that we are to condemn in the name of Jesus. Amen. So we have that. We don't have to be nervous about that. But the devil's flat ticked off because his authority or his little kingdom he set up here is starting to come down because we're setting up for the end of the days, end of days, praise God. And God is going to come back to a church that's full of His glory and full of His anointing and His power. And there's going to be thousands upon thousands upon thousands upon thousands of people come to Christ before we're out of here. And we are the people, we are the remnant that God has chosen in these last days to deliver the good news, to deliver the love, to deliver the power of the gospel. Amen? And I'll tell you something. You think about your life. Just you saying, Jesus, come into my heart is enough power to blow the devil out of your life. And that's all you need to deliver to these people. Just the name of Jesus. And it'll change their life. And I believe, and I really believe, that part of that promise that the Lord has given His body, He says He's coming back for a glorious church without spot or wrinkle. He says, part of that promise of Him coming back for that glorious church, I believe when we leave this place, the fullness of the glory of God will be at such a manifestation that it'll be like we just stepped right over into heaven. Man, that sounds pretty wild. I can't believe I just said that.
Love it.
I don't even know what that's like. I'm taking a risk right now saying that because I don't even know what heaven's like.
Yeah.
We've felt the anointing. We felt the love of God. We felt the peace of God. We felt His joy. We felt things of heaven. Maybe in our lives, in certain times of our lives or whatever, we felt the fire of God. We felt the electricity of God. You know, we felt His peace and His love. You know, we've tasted a bit of heaven here on earth.
Yeah.
But I feel like, and I know that I have not even seen anything close to what I think we're getting ready to see on this earth, guys.
Yeah, right.
And this isn't just a message tonight. I didn't even know I was going to be even saying any of this tonight. But this isn't a message tonight just to get everybody to feel good. And, oh, yeah, that's going to happen. Woo-hoo. No, this is reality.
That's right.
Expect it.
Yeah.
Start looking for it.
Yeah.
I know there's more.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I'm happy with where I'm at with the Lord right now personally, and I'm sure you are too, but there's more though.
More
we can't make that more happen. We just got to follow where the more is at.
Exactly.
Amen.
Go deeper.
That's a good word right there.
Right. Yeah.
Deeper. We just got to get deeper and deeper with Him. Because guys, we're not just Mike Purcell, Sister Sabrina, Brother Clarence, Brother Ron. We're not just Sister Linda from good old Madera, California.
Amen.
That's right.
Yeah.
Right.
We were put here
for a purpose.
That's right. for his stewardship.
And I really believe that the momentum that we're in right now with the power of God and the word, the revelation and the knowledge that God's pouring out to us, not only as individuals, but also as the corporate body of things we're hearing, the prophets and the generals and some of these people say about what's coming. You know, I believe that it's coming. It's coming. It's already started. There's been little things breaking out all over the place. And as this world system, as this demonic system starts to crumble, and it starts to just, I mean, implode on itself, because that's what's happening. I mean, some of this stuff, some of these demonized people say is absolutely ludicrous. Yeah, it doesn't make any sense at all. The devil doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
Only to them. And I pray for those people because they need Jesus. But the devil will use people that he's got a hold of. And people are, even people that aren't even following Christ, people that have the wisdom that we have concerning the love of God and what this thing's all about, they're even recognizing that it's just craziness, it's chaos. Yeah. That's why they're turning to something that's real. Your coworkers, your friends, your family, your neighbor, they see peace on you, they see love on you, they see compassion on you, and they know they need it. Folks, I'll tell you right now, and I don't know who's watching and all that kind of stuff live right now, or who's going to see this later, but I am watching my two sons leave a mark on people's lives.
Yeah, I believe it, yeah.
Of the love of Christ.
Wow.
And their coaches are seen.
Wow.
And they're asking questions. And doors are opening up for them to minister to their coaches.
Wow.
That is so loud. That's almost unheard of. And I'm not just saying that because they're my sons. I mean, yeah, I'm bragging on them, man. I'm proud of it. As a father. But that's where we're at right now. People do see the love of Christ in us. Not all of them are going to ask for it right now, but you got some of them that are being attracted to it right now. You can think about people right now, probably in your life, that you know God is getting ready to set them up, and you're getting ready just to minister the gospel to them, and they're going to come into the kingdom. It's happening. It's everywhere right now. Be looking for it, man. It's everywhere. Everywhere you go, there's opportunities.
Spreading embers.
God is fanning that flame. He's using us to fan those embers to get those things burning. Amen? So, it says, chapter 5, verse... Well, no, actually, let's look over here. Turn over to Hebrews real quick.
Ooh, going to have some coffee.
Yeah. Going to have some coffee. Hebrews. I know, it's kind of funny. Some of the churches have their coffee, you know, things in their church, and some of the names are Hebrews. I'm like, oh man, come on. Hebrews chapter 6. Look at verse 9. Hebrews 6, verse 9 says this. But beloved, talking to us, we are confident of better things concerning you, yes, things that accompany salvation, though we speak in this manner. Now listen to this, verse 10. For God is not unjust to forget your work and labor of love,
amen,
which you have shown towards His name, in that you have ministered to the saints and do minister. And we desire that each one of you show the same diligence to the full assurance of hope until the end, that you do not become sluggish, but imitate those who through faith and patience inherit the promises. Abraham inherited his promise.
Yes.
He tripped, he stubbed his toe, he went through some stuff, some doubt, some unbelief, but he finally came back around and grabbed a hold of that promise, and he didn't waver, and he allowed the Lord to use him. He allowed the Lord to work through him, praise God, and they were able to give birth and do what they needed to do, praise the Lord. And it says here that we are to imitate those through faith and patience and inherit the promises.
Amen.
Patience. Serving God, you're going to have to be patient.
Amen.
When I was going through leukemia in 2008, he would constantly bring, put, show me scriptures that had the word wait in them. I was learning patience. And I have grown in some of that over the years. Thank God. But see, amen. Paul says amen. Monica's not saying amen. She's like, yeah, whatever. No, but anyways. But as you are going through life and going through something, God knows when it's the time and the season for him to drop that in your lap, so to speak. Amen? So he says in the word to imitate those two promises. Now look at verse 13. For when God made a promise to Abraham, because he could swear by no one greater, he swore by himself, which was God, saying, surely blessing, I will bless you, and multiplying, I will multiply you. And so after he had patiently endured, he obtained the promise. Who's he talking about? He's talking about Abraham right there. And so after Abraham had patiently endured, he obtained the promise. For men indeed swear by the greater, talking about God, and an oath for confirmation is for them an end of all dispute. Thus God determining to show more abundantly to the heirs of promise and the immutability of his counsel confirmed it by an oath. Now listen, an oath. That by two, what are the two things that, well, actually it says, that by two immutable things, now that word immutable things means they're unchangeable. An oath. Once God makes an oath, it's unchangeable. It's established in covenant. That's it. Once he makes an oath to you and makes a promise to you, it's established. That is it. It's covenant. He's not going to break it. You can try to break it, but he's not going to break it. You can receive that promise or not. It's up to you, but it's done. It's established. It's settled. That's it. It's an oath of God. Now, see, you notice, now I'm starting to get some revelation here. This is awesome. Yeah. You notice that Abraham, he heard that promise, but he got over and tried to do it himself. That didn't change the fact that God already made the promise to him.
Right.
But Abraham, okay, all right, Lord, I stubbed my toe. Forgive me. I shouldn't have did what I did. I'm willing to get back over into that. I will not waver, and I believe what you said. And boom, God, the oath came through. God did what he said he was going to do. So it says here, and that by two. Now those two things there he's talking about is number one, God's promise. And number two, the blood covenant. That's it. It's over. The blood settled. The blood covenant settled it for you. All you had to do, and like you've done, is say, Jesus, I give you my life. Come into my heart. I'll serve you, Father. That's it. The promise was there, Jesus, and the blood covenant. That's the number two there, the two. That's it. It's established. That's it. The blood has done it. Boom, here we go. Now just believe it and let's go.
Amen.
What does blood do for you? It gives you life. If your blood stops pumping, what happens? You die. Blood gives you life. Hallelujah. So, that by two immutable things, which is God's promise and the blood covenant, in which it is impossible for God to lie, we might have strong consolation who have fled for refuge to lay hold of the hope or the expectation set before us. This hope we have, now listen to this, this hope we have as an anchor of the soul. An anchor of the soul. Who and what are you fastened to?
Yeah. That's right.
What is anchoring you? Who is anchoring you? Who are you fastened to?
Amen.
Who's the stable one in your life? Those guys on that ship, when they drop that anchor, they expect that anchor to grab and they expect not to move.
Amen?
Amen. So, I believe, and I could be wrong and Dad could correct me, but I believe that anchor is Jesus.
Yes.
Yeah.
We need to fast. Who are we fastened to? What are we fastened to? Are we fastened to the... We should be fastened to Jesus and Father God, the promise that He's given us. Fasten yourself to that promise.
Amen. Yeah.
Don't waver on it. Hold yourself there. The anchor of the soul is there. Jesus, He's there.
Yeah, come on.
Yeah. Hallelujah. And it says, as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, and which enters the presence behind the veil. Verse 20, where the forerunner has entered for us, even Jesus, having become high priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek. Now let me read this little commentary here in my Bible concerning verses 13 through 17. We just read them. It says this, we have in God and in His express purpose to bless us in Christ grounds for confident expectation. The fulfillment of His promise to Abraham provides assurance that He is certain to perform what He promises.
Amen.
He's promised you, your children, then bless God, your children will enter the kingdom of heaven.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. Say it again, Dad.
Psalms
112. You can write that down, some of you, for that. Your children. He's promised to use you in a certain type of ministry or a certain type of gift. You see God using you in those things. Praise God. You anchor yourself in those things and you allow Him to use you in those things and allow Him to expand you in those things.
Amen.
Praise God. But His promises, guys, are being fulfilled.
Amen.
They are.
As we speak. They are. He's shown you some things about your children. You just keep speaking those promises over your kids.
Right. Right.
Over your grandkids. You keep speaking those promises over them. You keep speaking.
Yes.
Keep giving life to them. Praise God. And be patient. Be patient. The devil will try to get you worried about your kids or worried about your grandkids or worried about your own life. Even the promises God's given you, he'll get you worried. Oh, those things ever going to come to pass? Are my kids ever going to come in? Is this ever going to happen? The devil tries to distract you and get you to waver. Fasten yourself to that anchor.
That's right.
And if you have to tell the devil to shut up 20 times in one day about that, you just tell him to shut up and you just stay anchored to that anchor. Stay fastened to that anchor. Steadfast.
Hallelujah.
Holding on to Jesus. Those precious promises, Lord, you show me that. Lord, you said, I will live and not die and declare the works of the Lord.
Amen.
Whatever it is in your life.
Wow.
I mean, you could sit here, you know, if I gave everyone a piece of paper and said, write down five things that God has promised you over the years, I guarantee you can write five things down. There's things God has shown you. Promised you. And there's more than that, I guarantee it. And what's awesome about God is even when He tells you something, maybe He told you it 20 years ago, 30 years ago, 40 years ago, you'll never forget it. He'll always bring it back. Even if your mind forgot it, He'll bring it back into your spirit. And I've noticed this, that a lot of times, even when you forgot about something, and all of a sudden something comes back up, it's getting ready to happen.
Yeah.
It's getting ready to be fulfilled.
Yes. Right. Yes, yes, yes.
Start looking for it.
That's right.
Started looking for it. You know, I had a lady come up to me today after service, and she said, you know, as pastor was preaching, I looked over at you, and when I looked over at you, I heard the Lord say this to me. I said, well, what was it? And she said, I heard the Lord say to me that you've gone to another level in Him with some of the stuff that He wants you to do, but He's getting ready to hand you another talent.
Wow.
And when He hands you that other talent, and you receive that other talent, I saw you as tent pegs. And I saw Him expanding. That scripture there where it talks about the tent pegs are expanding, you're taking ground, you're taking territory. Well, I saw, and see, she said that, and when she said that, there's like three or four things that God has said to me over the past 6 years that is exactly right along those lines. See, God showed me about 4 years ago, I saw a vision of a tent and its pegs expanding. As it expanded, it was overtaking the darkness.
Yeah.
I saw that about 6 years ago, maybe a little less. I don't know, 5 years or so.
Amen.
And then all of a sudden, Grandma Pat came up to me, she said, you know, I was praying for you, and the Lord told me, this has been about 5 years ago, it was right after I saw that vision. She said, the Lord spoke to me and told me that that God is getting ready to expand your ministry, and you're gonna your pegs and your tent pegs are getting ready to expand. Which is growth. It's gonna start growing, you know. And then I had a pastor from Fresno that I didn't even know at the time. I had just met him. He came up to me and said the exact same word to me about 2 weeks later after Grandma Pat said that. And then I had that vision of seeing those, or I saw those tent pegs and all that kind of stuff. And then the Lord spoke to me and said, it's time to take ground and occupy. Well, that goes right along with those lines, amen. So there's this process of God showing me things, God saying, using people to say things to me. And then I had this lady come up to me today and say that, so I'm getting ready for that expansion.
Yeah.
I'm getting ready for that.
Yeah.
I'm staying prepared, I'm staying fastened to the anger, and I'm just going throughout my day, going throughout my week, praise God, with the relationship with God, and God will take me into what He needs to take me. That's a promise to me. That's a promise He's given me. So I'm looking for it. I'm being patient, but I'm looking for it. Amen? Hallelujah. Praise God. So look, these things that God has shown you and said to you, man, maybe some of you need to go back even and just look back at some of the things He said to you, you've written down in your Bible or you have on paper or something like that. Start pulling those things back out, man. Start reading over those things. I have a folder full of words over the years, decades, that have been spoken to me personally. And some of you might not have stuff like that written down, but ask the Lord to remind you again. Lord, those words that brother so-and-so said to me, what were they, Lord? I don't remember them. Can you bring them back up into my spirit, Lord? And He'll do it for you. The Bible even says He'll remind you of things that you forgot. He'll bring them back.
Right.
To bless you.
That's right.
But I've noticed, when God starts saying stuff, man, and there's a period of time there where He's saying the same thing over and over to you again, It's to get that in you. It's to get you to grab a hold of that, believe that, and to look into that more. Because the time's coming where it's getting ready to happen in your life. That promise is going to come to pass.
That's right. Yeah.
And guys, there's a lot of promised people in this place tonight. A lot of things are getting ready to start coming forth.
Thank you, Lord.
Concerning some of those promises. We're not just so-and-so from the Central Valley.
That's right.
We are children of God. With power and authority and might. And we have a voice. And our voice is very loud and very clear when we speak the oracles of God. It causes hell to shake. It causes demons to leave, praise God. And it causes the glory of God and the light of God to come into an area or a region. And that's what I believe is happening. Because people are praying. People have finally got a hold of it. That's why our nation is changing. Because people have gotten on their knees over the past 15, 20 years and started to realize we need God back in this place. It's happening. It's happening. The race has started. We're not at the finish line. We're not at the starting line anymore. We're running.
That's right. Come on.
We're running.
Amen.
There's not going to be a feeble one among our tribe. We're going, man. We are earth shakers, man.
That's right.
Awesome.
Madera is going to shake.
Oh, yeah.
Under the power and the glory of God.
There's going to be a lot of jail left. There's nobody committing crime.
Amen.
There's a lot of ship of hospital down. There's nobody sick.
Amen. I believe it, Ron. I want it.
Yeah. Amen.
I want to see
that.
I want to see. I want to see people come out of hospital beds, man. I want to see things happen like that. It's happened before. It could happen again.
Amen.
Yeah. Nothing's too great for our God.
Amen.
We need to stand for that.
Amen. Funny. Amen. This town is about to shake because the Lord gave me a word back in December before New Year's, and it's pricey this year. He said, you're saying that this, there's going to be a shake to happen, and both spiritually and naturally.
Mm-hmm.
And this was before the earthquake. I don't know if you remember the earthquake.
Vaguely, yeah.
Back then, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like 2 or 3 weeks. Anyways, he was saying that there's going to be a shake and a shift.
Shake and a shift, yeah. Well, that's, and yeah, and I believe that, and I believe it's already started. I believe that shaking has already started. We don't, we can see it naturally in areas around the world and around our country and things like that. But I believe a lot of shaking is going on in the church.
Starts in the house of God.
Amen. 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 Things are being shaken. And I say, God, shake me, man.
Yeah.
Shake everything off that I don't need. Shake everything off that's extra baggage. Shake it off. I'm like, I want to be like David. Lord, if there's anything on the inside of me, Lord, take it from me. I don't want it.
Lord.
Anything that's not of you, Lord. That's humbleness. And that's the people that God will use mightily. And I believe that's us, guys. We have hearts for God. Everybody in here, I know, loves Jesus with all their heart. And everybody in here is a blessing. I know that for a fact. But I really believe God's getting ready to turn it up a little more for you. So be ready.
Amen.
Be ready to walk right in His promises. Amen. Dad, you have something? Nothing? Okay. Thank you, Father.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Lord, we thank you.
Yes.
We thank you for that. Yeah, Lord. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Someone in here been having problems with their lungs lately? Like, I don't know. Just, well, I know Monica's been having a little bit of a cough, but you, ma'am? Okay. All right. Well, let me just pray right now.
Thank you, Lord.
Father, in the name of Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, I thank you for my sister right now,
thank
Lord.
You.
Thank you, God.
Father, I just thank you right now for your healing power, Lord. And Father, I ask you right now in the name of Jesus Christ just to touch my sister's lungs right now, Father God. I ask you for health to spring forth in her lungs in the name of Jesus. And Lord, I ask you right now, Lord, just to create new lungs if need be, Father God. Lord, I know, yeah, I see that you've already started something on the inside of that area, Lord. I thank you that you finished that, Lord God. And Lord, I thank you for your miracle working power in the name of Jesus. Lord, I ask you to create new lining in her lungs in the name of Jesus. I thank you that her lungs are as healthy as a child's lungs, Lord. I ask you for that, Father. I ask you for mercy right now in that area in the name of Jesus. And Lord, I thank you from this moment on. You've already started it, but Lord, I thank you that you finish that work right now in my sister's lungs in the name of Jesus. And we ask this in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen. Amen. Someone online is having problems in their lungs?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, you?
My mother has problems with her lungs.
Oh. You too?
Our youngest grandchild was diagnosed about 3 days ago with a respiratory virus in his lungs, and so I wrote a prayer request for him.
Okay, that's what that, okay, yeah, I saw that. Okay, what's his name?
Bex, he's about 15 months old.
Bex, that's kind of a different name. Bex, that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
All right, that lady's online right now. Father, in the name of Jesus,
thank you, Father.
I thank you for this person that's online, Lord. In the name of Jesus, I thank you, Father God, for healing her lungs, strengthening her lungs, creating new lungs if need be, Father, in the name of Jesus. I thank you that angels go forth right now to minister healing and a touch from heaven in her life in Jesus' name. And Lord, I thank you for Bex right now, Father. I curse this virus. I command it to get out of his little body right now in the name of Jesus. I speak to his lungs. I command them to clear up. I command him to breathe normal now in the name of Jesus. I thank you that by tomorrow morning, his parents will see, Father God, a difference in his breathing and the sound that his lungs are making in the name of Jesus Christ. Touch this child right now, Father. In Jesus' name, and you'll do it. Yes, I know. Thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus. And Lord, thank you for Glenn. You said it was your mother? Or who? Yeah, your mother.
My mother, and her lungs are fine. Diet nice.
Okay. Okay, Father, what's her name?
Barbara.
Barbara. Father, I thank you for Barbara. We lift her up right now before you, Lord. And I ask you to touch Barbara's lungs right now, Father. I thank you for giving her more years of life, Father God. I thank you for touching her life right now. And Lord, I thank you that the fire of God just rests upon her chest right now, Lord. And she senses a sensation of Father God, of healing going forth through her body right now in the name of Jesus. I ask you in the name of Jesus Christ, Father, to touch Barbara right now, wherever she's at, in Jesus' name. Be healed, Barbara, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Be healed in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus. Lord, thank you for Monica, too, Lord. Thank you for her lungs, healing her lungs, helping her. Command this cough to go in Jesus' name. And I command clarity in her lungs in her life. I thank you for good sleep. I thank you for peace and health and joy in the Holy Spirit in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. In Jesus' name. Yeah.
I have a friend, I just heard a report that his son, he's in his 30s, has been diagnosed with diabetes. And it was a real life threatening thing until they got it under control. He said, Corey.
Okay, there's a young man named Corey that's been, he's in his 30s, was diagnosed with diabetes, and they were asking for prayer. So let's lift Corey up right now. Father, in Jesus' name, I come before you with Corey right now, Lord. You know Corey, you created Corey, you know where he's at, you know what he's doing, Lord. So Father, I ask you right now, in Jesus' name, we curse diabetes, we command it to get out of Corey's body, we lift him before you, Father, we stand in the gap for Corey right now, Lord, and we release by faith and by our mouth authority and healing in the name of Jesus Christ. Be healed, Corey, right now by the blood of the Lamb. Be healed right now by the stripes of Jesus Christ. We command healing in your blood, healing in your body in Jesus' name. We call life into you right now in the name of Jesus Christ. And Lord, I ask you and thank you that you will, Father God, get all the glory and all the honor for healing this young man right now in the name of Jesus. I ask you just to touch him right now, Lord. Thank you for miracles, signs, and wonders in his life in the name of Jesus.
Thank you.
Yes, in the name of Jesus.
Thank
you. Yeah. I had a quick little comeback moment.
Okay. Wow.
And then it went into like yellow things flowing away. But it said she's not saved. So, can we believe together for her?
Yeah, absolutely. He said he saw just the fire of God come on. He saw a lady laying in bed. And as we were praying, he said he saw the fire of God just come on her chest and heal her. And he was saying that Barbara's not saved. She's not born again.
Not at all. And not only that, she said at nighttime, her soul was left.
Wow. So she's, okay, well, she's not saved, so let's pray for Barbara right now, all right? Let's do that.
It's funny that Ron said that, I saw the same thing when we prayed for Monica.
Oh, amen. Awesome. Okay, good. Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for Barbara. Lord, we stand in the gap for her soul right now, Father. We ask you, Father, in the name of Jesus, that you will either send someone into her life to minister the gospel to her, to reach her, Father God, or we ask you, Father God, to give her an experience that, Father, that she'll be saved by fear if have to be, Father God. Your word says that some people have to be saved by that, Lord. So, Father, I ask you for her soul. I ask you for laborers into her vineyard, Father God. Lord, if that's us, we're available to do that, Father God. But we pray in Jesus' name that Barbara will come into the kingdom before she leaves the earth. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And Lord, I thank you for healing her, Father. That she sees that you love her and that you adore her, and that she is your beloved, Father God. I ask you to do that for her, Father. Yeah, now let me say this, Lord. I ask you to have mercy upon Barbara, Lord. I cry out mercy. Have mercy on Barbara. Have mercy on Barbara, God. That she'll come to know you, Father. In the name of Jesus.
Yes.
We ask you for mercy on her.
I got the word hell snatch.
Hell snatch. Jesus is a hell snatcher.
Mike, the word hereditary. Diseases that are hereditary, that have come down your family lineage. I have a word from the Lord to take authority over that right now.
Yes.
And just, I feel like it's for people in here and for people online as well.
Yes.
Father, in Jesus' name, I take dominion and authority according to what the Holy Spirit just said to me. I take authority over every hereditary disease, discomfort of the enemy that would come, Father, that has infected the lineage of people's families. We thank you, Lord, that we're in your family now. We thank you that we've had a blood transfusion of the life of God. And so in the name of Jesus, I command every hereditary disease to bow its knees. I release the blood to flow throughout your body, and the blood of Jesus cleanses and purges and even resets if necessary, and even creates if necessary. But every hereditary thing that's come down through your lineage, we take authority over it, and we say in Jesus' name it's replaced by the life of God. The law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made you free from the laws of sin and death. And open the door to those hereditary diseases. In Jesus' name, I command you in Jesus' name to lose this. Thank you for the power of God, Lord. In Jesus' name. Now, some of them are not life-threatening. Some of them are just harassment, characteristics, bad characteristics, wrong characteristics, or whatever, however you want to say it. Other things are more life-threatening. But in Jesus' name, they are subjected this night.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus.
Yes, and that's a good word, Dad, because I really believe that there's people in here the devil's been lying to and telling you that that's going to happen to you, or that's going to happen to your kids, or whatever. He's been trying to lie to me about some stuff like that, too. So I believe that's right on target now. Amen. Amen. Well, let's stand up. Praise God.
I was going to say one thing real
quick. Yeah, absolutely.
Last time our church, we prayed for her here. I didn't even talk to her. The next morning I called her, and she goes, I can hear.
Amen. So we prayed for Barbara for her hearing one day.
She
called her the next day, and she could hear.
First thing she said,